Okay, yes, please introduce yourself.
Good morning, sir. My name is Yash Avinash Katakwar. I have been working in the Life Insurance Corporation of India for the past one year and 2 months. I have joined LIC as a apprentice development officer, and after rigorous training of 2 months, I got promoted to PDO, which is the probationary development officer, which I've been working since the last February. So I have a year's experience with me right now in selling and knowing about the insurance products and the insurance market. So my job role was basically to hire and recruit agents, teach them how to sell and how to be presentable, go on joint calls with them at the start so that I can help them progress in their field. And then once they are big enough, they can sell, they just report to me. So this is about LIC. Now, about my education qualifications, I have done BSc in Actuarial Science, which is a relatively new degree. About Actuarial Science, it is a study of like the risks involved in insurance industry and investment products. So I cleared that in 2000. I completed my graduation in 2018 September. During this course of events, I also qualified two actuarial papers from Institute and Faculties of Actuaries, which are my professional qualifications. First being the CT one, which is called, since I apologize, I don't know the subject name. I will prepare that when I go to the interview. CT one and CT five, and I will explain what it is. And then about my...
Yes, tell me one thing.
Yes, sir.
As you're working in LIC as ADO, so why do you want to join any Nestle Life Bank? What is the reason behind it?
So the sole reason behind me leaving from LIC and joining a highly reputed public sector bank is because COVID has exposed the realities and fragilities of the real world. LIC being a marketing job, I can't, at this age, I can roam in the market and recruit more people and train new people. But when I come back home, I have to support my family, which are basically my retired mom and dad. So if they are safe at home, avoiding COVID, and if I'm going in the market, catching COVID, I would prefer a desk job over this.
How your LIC experience as you are recruiting your agents, then you are giving him the guideline how to sell the product, whatever it may be. Yes, how your experience is going to help with our bank?
That's a nice question, sir. I would like... Basically, that was my first job of my life, being in a government institution of such a humongous and mammoth size. So I came to know about the intricate workings of the things, like how to get work done. That is also a skill in government unit. So basically, I learned teamwork. My team was of 5 agents. So I had to coordinate them on a daily basis. And whatever information I used to get from them, I used to process, give it to my higher ups. So I have learned coordination among them. If there's...
Can you give the differences between the marketing and selling? What are the differences? Or both the things are the same? Can the difference
no,
be both things?
Actually, I saw a video on YouTube half a year back about difference between marketing and selling. I'm not able to recall the exact things. But the slight thing which I am able to recall is selling is basically directly selling the product of the brand which you are associated with. Marketing is basically forwarding your word of mouth, like building reputation for it so that people have a desire to get involved in that product or at least be associated with it. So this, according to me, this is the difference.
See, if you have gone through the different newspaper or television news, you must have seen that number of public sector banks are going to be privatized, like Bank of India, and so many 4 leading banks are going to get privatized. So what do you think, why this step has taken by Government of India, whether these steps are good, or what is your opinion regarding privatization of banks?
Okay. So about the privatization of banks, how much I have heard and learned, read about it. It is basically only about those banks who are in the bad light, like who have accrued a large amount of NPAs and who are not the banks which are not performing well. So basically the government's idea is to start with those banks on a trial run see how it proceeds, and if it is a successful venture, then carry out to other banks. But right now,
don't you think the steps which you are going to take now, that is to joining a public sector bank, after a few years down the line, these banks will also become privatized. So why don't you want to continue with LIC? Rather, you want to come to the bank whose future is not secure. Whenever these banks will be privatized, no one knows. So why you are taking this step that you want to be the part of public sector banks?
Another good question, sir. My reply to this would be, at the end of the day, whether public or a private sector, what matters is efficiency. If I do my work religiously and if I do it without diligently, then I don't think it would matter. Like it would
How
be much
can
of
you
a
calculate your efficiency. How okay. can you calculate your efficiency?
Can I have a minute to think about it, sir?
Yes. Okay, yes, tell me one thing. Yes. So what is the meaning of this particular name? Does this
actually mean... I've been chasing my name definition since the childhood.
Okay. So
and I guess if I clear this interview and get selected in your reputed bank, I would have literally succeeded or proven my name's worth.
Fine. Okay, yes. I have one more question. Yes, related sir. To your future.
Okay.
Right. So if you will be selected as assistant manager, as provisionary officer in any of the nationalized bank, where you want to see yourself after 3 years?
Okay. So my life goals are, I need to get a stable job, at least as of now. If I get a stable job, I can think about the various options like MBA or the professional papers which I've cleared. And given that your reputed bank has given me an opportunity to explore those, I will pledge my undying loyalty towards it while pursuing this. But my immediate plans would be to pursue a distance MBA course or at least add something to my educational repertoire.
Okay, tell me one thing. If you will qualified after 5 months or 1 year down the line in the State Bank of India or Reserve Bank of India, what will be your course of action?
Pardon me, I couldn't hear the last part.
Suppose you will be selected as a provisionary officer or RBI grade B officer in a State Bank or Reserve Bank of India respectively. So what you will do?
Okay, can I go off the record here? I have a doubt here.
No. Please give your answer. Then we will have another discussion.
Okay. So basically my sister is working as an RBI assistant in BKC office. So the reason I joined this line was to become an RBI assistant. But considering that my first interview is in IBPS PO, if I get posted as a probationary officer in any of the public sector banks, I always think it is better than a assistant in RBI. And about the grade B or officer in RBI, a man should always jitni chadar honi chahiye utni pair phailane chahiye. So I really, frankly speaking, sincere apologies, but I don't even attempt the grade B examinations. I might if I get some experience in public sector banks down the line, but way down the line.
The USP of LIC?
The USP of LIC is like ask you another question about your question. Who was the first man to land on the moon? Who was the first man to land on the moon or walk on the moon?
Okay, Neil Armstrong, I think.
Yeah. And who was the second one?
Second, I don't know.
Yeah. So basically, that's what the USP of LIC is. Being in the insurance market at the first and being the government being a government organization, there is a called a domain name. So whenever the USP of LIC is like, even if you have a HDFC policy or a SBI policy, people ask, aapke paas LIC hai kya? That's the unique selling point of LIC. And after the opening up of the insurance sector, the bill got passed in 1999 and it came into effect in 2000. All the major foreign players tried to enter the market and it was thought it is the doom of LIC. But their mistake was they focused only on the metro cities and the urban population. The penetration which LIC has, which is still not at the minimum level,
whenever nowadays, if you are going to any nationalized bank or any private sector banks, they are giving more emphasis on selling of third party products.
Okay.
So why banks are taking this step of selling third party product, insurance product, general insurance product? What are the basic reason behind it?
Sorry, sir, I don't know about that, but I will surely look into it after this interview.
Fine. In 2015 or 16, in the period, Government of India has launched one DBT scheme.
In 2015 and 16?
DBT scheme, are you aware of this?
No, sir. Can you? Your voice is lagging. What is, which scheme?
DBT. What is DBT scheme?
Direct benefit transfer.
What is this basically?
So basically, I have read an article about this in the Hindu. So basically, the Manrega scheme or the whatever money that the people used to work in this government schemes used to owe, they are now. This is the sole aim of this government. So what the government wants is that whatever the government owns for the services.
What is financial inclusion?
Pardon me?
What is financial inclusion?
Financial inclusion is in urban cities like you and me, we have a bank account, or we may have two or three bank accounts. But basically, the people who live in the outskirts or in the rural areas, they are at the helm of the landlords or the, there's a term I'm not getting, who have, kya bolte unko Hindi, sorry. Like they have to borrow money at very exorbitant interest rates and they are at the helm of them. Like it is not regulated. So their progress is hampered due to the repeated threats and the money recovering methods, and the extreme steps are they need to marry off their offsprings to.
Okay. You were working as a professionally officer in any of the nationalized bank. One customer came to your counter. He is a 65 years old pensioner, and he is asking you that he want to get his passbook updated, but unfortunately your passbook printer is not working. What you will suggest to the old customer?
I would first of all make him sit at a comfortable place and offer him a glass of water, and I would politely explain the situation to him, and if possible I may send someone to collect the passbook, his passbook if he is nearby. I would simply tell him to come at another day at his convenience, and I can understand given his old age it is hard to come, but I would sincerely apologize to him and make a humble request and make him feel as comfortable as possible right now.
Okay. Fine. Do we have any question?
As of now, none, sir.